So in previous class, we discussed about the inversion region. Now we will focus on the strong inversion. Okay. Okay. Today we'll talk about the strong inversion region and the depletion region in detail. So we'll start with the strong inversion. We'll see how we can get an expression, charge expression, simplified charge expression for strong inversion regime of device operation. Okay. So if you recall the surface potential versus gate to body voltage curve. At x-axis I am taking gate to body voltage, y-axis I am taking surface potential. So it was something like this, okay, and at psi s equal to phi f, basically VGB is equal to VLO, we have discussed earlier, and at psi s equal to twice phi f, the VGB was equal to VMO, okay, and when psi s is equal to twice phi f plus say 6 phi t, when psi s is equal to twice phi f plus 6 phi t, then surface potential becomes constant and the gate to body voltage VGB at which this is going to happen is, let us say, noted as VHO. Okay. So the three regions are shown here from phi f to twice phi f, when psi s varies from phi f to twice phi f, and therefore VGB varies from VLO to VMO. We identified this as a weak inversion region, and when VGB varies from VMO to VHO, we identified this as a moderate inversion region, and for VGB beyond VHO, we identified this as a strong inversion region. Okay. So a strong inversion happens when psi s is equal to twice phi f plus 6 phi t, and for further increment in VGB, the surface potential doesn't change significantly. The change in the surface potential can be neglected, and therefore you can see the surface potential therefore is shown as a constant here. Okay. So we can say that at the onset of strong inversion, at the onset of strong inversion, the surface potential is pinned to psi s is pinned to phi naught, where phi naught is nothing but twice phi f plus, let's say, phi z naught, where this phi z naught can be written equal to 6 phi t. Okay. So since we have we have noticed this interesting property of the surface potential becomes constant for further increment with VGB. So we can utilize this property in order to find out a simplified charge relation, charge voltage relation in the strong inversion regime of the device operation. Okay. The charge general expression for the charge density, as you know, the charge density can be written as Qi prime is Qc prime minus Qb prime. So Qx VGB minus VFB minus this surface potential. This is what? This is QC prime. And when I subtract QB prime from QC prime, then I will get the QI prime. As I said you that, as we discussed earlier, that the total semiconductor charge QC prime is basically sum of the inversion charge density plus bulk charge density QB prime. So QI prime here is equal to QC prime minus QB prime, and with the help of charge balance and potential balance equation, QC prime can be written as COx into VGB minus VFB minus psi s, the surface potential. Okay, so now here if I also take this QB prime inside this bracket, then it must be minus COx prime into VGB minus VFB minus psi s minus QB prime upon COx. Okay. In a strong inversion, basically the charge density, as you know, the charge density expression QB prime is equal to minus 2Q, QB prime, the charge density expression QB prime can be now written as minus square root of 2Q epsilon s Na into square root of psi s. And at the onset of strong inversion, as you have seen earlier, at the onset of strong inversion, the surface potential becomes equal to phi naught, where phi naught is twice phi f plus phi z naught. So I can substitute here in this expression, and I can get the expression for the bulk charge density QB prime at the onset of strong inversion. So it becomes minus 2Q epsilon s Na into square root of phi naught. Okay, so this is our bulk charge density QB prime, and you can also notice here that in strong inversion, the bulk charge density QB prime is basically a function, is independent with surface potential. Okay, because surface potential has become constant, and QB prime is the charge density, bulk charge density is basically the charge density in the depletion region. It means that since surface potential, since with VGB, there is no change in the surface potential becomes constant to twice phi naught. So charge density has also become constant. QB prime has also become constant. Acceptor ion density, acceptor ion, uncovered acceptor ion density at the onset of a strong inversion, in the strong inversion becomes constant, and that is equal to minus 2Q epsilon s Na into square root of phi naught. There is also another implication of this. It simply means that the depletion region has the depth of the depletion region has reached to its maximum value, and therefore the depth of the depletion, let's say it is represented as D max. So this D max has reached to its maximum value, and now with the increment in VGB, there is no further increment in the depth of the depletion region if the strong inversion has already occurred in the MOS capacitor. Getting my point? Because this QB prime is related with, is QB prime is nothing but the charge density in this depletion region, and if the depth of the depletion region has reached to its maximum value, with VGB there is no further increment in Dmax, therefore the QB prime has also become constant. Okay, and we can use this QV prime expression in the inversion charge density expression that we had talking about. QI prime is minus UX prime VGV minus VFB minus IS minus IS and it was minus QB prime here. And now we can take this QB prime inside this bracket. So it becomes minus UX prime VGB minus VFB minus IS plus QB prime upon CUX. CUX prime. Okay. Am I correct? Am I right? Okay. And now, since we are dealing with the strong inversion, so strong inversion, psi s has now becomes equal to phi naught. So this psi s may be replaced by phi naught, and the QB prime will be replaced by this expression. Okay. So what we will have, the inversion charge density QI prime is now minus UX prime VGB minus VFB minus phi naught, and this now QB prime is with minus sign, so minus 2Q epsilon S into NA divided by COX into square root of phi naught. Okay, is it okay to all of you? Now if you look at the last three terms, okay, just look at the last bracketed terms. It is square root of 2q epsilon s na upon cox. Okay, this term. So what is this? If you recall it, if you can recall it, anybody?
Sir, body effect parameter.
This is body effect parameter gamma. Okay, so I can replace this by gamma, and I will be able to write down the charge density QI prime minus COX VGV minus VFB minus phi naught minus phi naught minus C gamma into square root of phi naught. Okay. And now if you look at the last three terms of this expression, okay, if you have already studied the MOS transistor, then you might be familiar about a parameter called threshold voltage. Okay, so threshold voltage is basically for a MOS transistor looks similar to this, and here again the three terms together will be defined as a extrapolated threshold voltage, extrapolated threshold voltage, extrapolated threshold voltage VT naught. So VT naught is basically VFB plus phi naught plus gamma time square root of phi naught. Okay. So I can substitute VTO here in place of these three terms, and I will be able to write down the charge density in a strong inversion as a COX into VGB minus VTO. Okay, so here is a very very simple relation for QI and VGB. As you can see, QI prime, the charge density in a strong inversion region varies linearly with gate to body voltage. Okay, so if you are sure that the MOS cap VGB is such a so high that the MOS cap has already, the substrate has already entered into the strong inversion, then we can utilize this simple expression for the charge density. QI prime simply minus COX VGB into VTO. Okay, So if you plot this QI prime versus VGB, okay, emphasizing the strong inversion regime of operation, then we can see this graph. Okay, so QI prime here is basically plotted against the gate to body voltage VGB, and you can see that initially the charge density is very low, and when this curve you have already seen, in fact. Okay, so the point that I want to make here is when the MOS cap is already in the strong inversion region, means when VGB is greater than VHO in this regime. So in this regime, basically this QI prime can be considered to be varying proportional to can be given as minus UX prime into VGB minus VTO. It can be considered that the QI prime, the inversion charge density, is varying linearly with gate to body voltage in this section when VGB has gone above this value VHO. Okay. So if we extrapolate this, why we call this VTO as an extrapolated threshold voltage, that is also clear from this graph. Okay, so if we extrapolate the QI VGB curve of strong inversion, of course this is the strong inversion regime. So in strong inversion, when we extrapolate this section, you see that this is going to cut this x-axis at VTO. Okay, because when VGB is equal to VTO, QI prime becomes zero. Okay, that's what this this section of the curve indicates, and that's why you see that the VTO is a VTO is here noted as a extrapolated threshold voltage. So how to define the extrapolated threshold voltage for a MOS capacitor? So we can define it like this: when at the onset of the extrapolated threshold voltage, how to define the strong inversion regime of the device operation? You can say that when the charge starts varying with VGB linearly, we can consider that the MOS cap has already entered into the strong inversion regime of the operation. And another interesting thing that you can note here is the position of this VTO. Generally, it is understood that the VTO is a property of the strong inversion regime of the MOS capacitor, but its value is actually this is now placed here in the moderate inversion regime. Okay, so this is the moderate inversion regime from VMO to VHO, and the threshold voltage value, extrapolated threshold voltage value, is actually in between this VMO and VHO. So extrapolated threshold voltage, although it is defined in the strong inversion regime of the device operation, but its value is somewhere between this VMO and VHO. Okay, so this is a good thing that we have got a very very simple relation between gate to body, between the gate to body voltage and the charge density VGB and VTO, QI prime and VGB, okay, in a strong inversion. So you'll see later on when we'll be talking about the MOS transistor. So there, when we'll calculate the inversion charge density and the current in the strong inversion region, we'll be directly using this charge density relation over there. Okay. Any question? Any doubt so far? It is all right. Okay, so now here is an exercise problem. Okay, and you can see that here for a MOS capacitor, which is a having p-type substrate, the doping level is mentioned, which is 10 to the power 18 per centimeter cube okay, and SiO2 thickness is given, that is 2 nanometer, and the gate is basically n-type polysilicon gate with ND equal to 10 to the power 20 impurity atoms per centimeter cube, per centimeter cube volume. Interfacial charge density is given as 10 to the power minus 18 coulomb per centimeter square. So for this, for the given parameter value, we have to find out extrapolated threshold voltage VTO. Okay. So as you have seen that VTO, the extrapolated threshold voltage, is equal to VFB plus phi naught plus gamma time of phi naught. Okay. And VFB, we have already discussed how to find VFB. VFB equal to phi ms minus q prime upon cox prime. Okay, so here you can see that phi m, the gate is basically n plus polysilicon gate. So you can find out the phi m will be equal to electron affinity of the silicon, and the phi s is basically the work function you have to find out for p type semiconductor with substrate doping 10 to the power 18 per centimeter cube. So you can get it, we have already done this. Q prime is given 10 to the power minus 8 coulomb per centimeter square. COx prime is basically epsilon ox upon tox. So this is again epsilon ox is known for the silicon, tox is given, that is 2 nanometer. Epsilon ox is permittivity of silicon dioxide. Okay, so from here you can compute COx prime, you can substitute this and you can get the flat band voltage. Phi naught is again known, phi naught can be obtained, phi naught equal to twice phi f plus let's say 6 phi t. So phi f is basically kt by q natural log of Na upon Ni. Na doping is given here. You can substitute the values. You can also find out the phi f here. Okay, so from phi f we can get phi naught, and gamma is body effect coefficient. Gamma is square root of 2 q epsilon s Na upon Cx prime. So again you can see the all terms are given in the problem. Na is given. Okay, COx is epsilon ox upon tox, so tox is given. You can find gamma from this expression, and then the terms VFB, phi naught, gamma can be substituted in this expression, and you will be able to find out the threshold voltage value for the MOS capacitor. Okay, so this is problem is solved in this lecture. I will share this with you, and you can also check the values. Okay. And you can solve this your own, and you can verify with the values given in the lecture sheet. Okay. I'm skipping this. So now let us concentrate to weak inversion region only. Okay. So the weak inversion, you know that is region when surface potential is between phi f to twice phi f. Okay, and in weak inversion, the charge density qi prime is equal to qc prime minus qb prime. So this is the total charge density. We have already discussed this in the previous class. This was this was because of the total semiconductor charge density QC prime, and this was because of the QB prime minus 2Q epsilon S Na into square root of psi S. Okay, so QI prime is known here, but in weak inversion regime, since surface potential is less than twice phi F, okay, then we can take advantage of this fact. So if psi S is less than twice phi F, then phi t e to the power psi s minus twice phi f upon phi t term is going to be very, very small. So we can consider that this phi t e to the power psi s minus twice phi f upon phi t is equal to x. Okay, and therefore by substituting this in this expression, we can use this. We are doing this in order to simplify this qi prime expression. Okay, we would like to get the charge density expression for the weak inversion regime of device suppression, and therefore we are making using this approximation psi s less than twice phi f, and also making this substitution phi t e to the power psi s minus twice phi f upon phi t equal to x. So just concentrate on this square root terms. So if phi t e to the power psi s minus twice phi f upon phi t is considered to be x, then this now becomes square root of psi s plus x. Okay, so since square root of psi s plus x, now this can be expanded using the Taylor series. Okay, we can take the first two terms of the Taylor series. We can expand the square root of psi s plus x around x equal to 0, and upon the expansion and neglecting the higher order terms, we can get this. Okay, square root of psi s plus x equal to square root of psi s plus 1 upon 2 square root of psi s into x. Okay, this is after the Taylor series expansions. Okay, and neglecting higher order terms. Okay, so this square root of psi s plus x, now this can be substituted in the charge density expression, and in charge density expression you had seen this minus square root of psi s term. So this term will be cancelled out by minus square root of psi s, and we will be left with only this term qi prime. So we will be left with only, you can see that here upon the after the expansion of the Taylor series, we got here as a square root of psi s plus 1 upon 2 square root of psi s into it was x, something like that. So this square root of psi s, this cancelled out, and we are left with only x, and x is basically phi t e to the power psi s minus twice phi f upon phi t. Okay, so substituting this x in this qi prime expression, we will be able to get the following expression for the charge density. Okay, so qi prime is basically minus 2 q epsilon s na in divided by 2 into square root of psi s into phi t e to the power psi s minus twice phi f upon phi t. Okay, but this is this relation, this remains valid only in the weak inversion regime of the device operation. Okay, and qi prime is varying with the surface potential. Okay, so if we have to find out a relation which will relate qi prime with gate to body voltage VGV, then basically we can utilize this surface potential expression psi s. You see, psi s say in the depletion region, or this can be extended also for the weak inversion region, is equal to minus gamma by 2 plus square root of gamma by 4, square root of gamma square by 4 plus VGB minus VFD. This we have discussed in the previous class. Okay, so we can use this in place of psi s here, and we will be able to express qi prime in terms of gate to body voltage. So gate to body voltage is known to us. We can directly substitute gate to body voltage in this expression in order to find out the inversion charge density qi prime. Okay, but this will be of course a complicated expression, because this psi sa is a square root of is a complicated expression, so qi prime eventually will become a complicated. So what we can do, we can see how the surface potential is varying with gate to body voltage, and we can make some simplification if we simply actually observe this expression. You see here that since surface potential with VGV curve in this section, in weak inversion section, to like the depletion section, the surface potential almost varies linearly with gate to body voltage. So we can write down a simple expression for VGV in this section utilizing the slope of this line, okay, and we'll be able to write down a simple expression for VGV in terms of VMO and some other parameters of this curve. Okay, so because this line is very simple, and let's say that the inverse of the slope of this line is 1 by n. Okay, so n is of course del psi s, the surface potential, versus del VGV inverse. Okay, so slope is 1 by n for this line, so slope of this line is delta psi s by delta VGV. Okay, so inverse of the slope is 1 by n, which is basically equal to del VG into del psi s. Okay, and we have already derived the expression for the surface potential in the depletion region, or that can also be extended in the weak inversion region. So psi s a equal to minus gamma by 2 plus square root of gamma square by 4 plus VGB minus VFB square of all. Okay, this relation we already have. So from this expression, I can find n, because I can take the derivative of this psi s a with respect to VGB, and as a result, I will be able to write down the expression for n as n equal to 1 plus utilizing the surface potential expression psi s a, and taking the derivative with respect to VGB and take the inverse of that, I will be able to write down the expression for n as 1 plus gamma into 2 upon square root of psi s a into VGB. Okay, so for once the expression for the slope is known, then we can try to relate the slope with gate to body voltage VGB. Okay, and there is another observation that in depletion region or in weak inversion region, you can see the surface potential psi is varying almost linearly with gate to body voltage VGB. Psi varies not exactly linearly, but psi varies with gate to body voltage slowly, but square root of psi will actually the variation, if we try to observe the variation of square root of psi s with VGB, then this will be very very small. So we can utilize this fact, we can just choose one point of observation, let's say it's here, and we can say that the psi s is fixed here at twice phi f value, so square root of psi s can be fixed to square root of twice into phi f. Okay, so using this fact, we can get a simplified expression for n at VGB equal to VMO. At VGB equal to VMO, let's say that n becomes n naught, and therefore n naught is 1 plus gamma upon 2 into psi s equal to twice phi f. Psi s is replaced by twice phi f here. So this entire exercise was intended to obtain the expression for n naught in terms of physical parameter. So n naught is derived here in terms of body effect coefficient gamma and the Fermi potential phi f. Okay, so you can see here that n naught, this n naught, now since the slope of n naught is known, the slope of the psi s versus v g curve is known, we can use this in order to find a simple relation between VGV, a simple relation for the VGV that could be substituted in the expression, in the charge expression, to get a charge expression in the weak inversion regime of the device operation. Okay, so if we go back to the psi s versus VGV curve, then we can consider one. We can consider that this section is a linear section. This variation is a linear variation, almost linear variation, and one point here is the coordinate of this point is twice phi f and VMO. Okay, and let us choose an arbitrarily at any position here. Let us say that this is the surface potential psi s, and correspondingly we have a get to body voltage VGV. Okay, so on this section of the line we have the coordinates of the two points. One is twice phi f comma VMO, and another coordinate is, let's say, psi s and VGV, and we already know the slope of this section, which is 1 upon n naught, so which is basically n, the slope of this section is n. So we can relate this VGV with surface potential. We can write down the expression of this line in terms of these coordinates, and the expression for the surface get to body voltage in terms of surface potential is going to be like this: psi s minus VGV, psi s minus twice phi f is equal to m, the slope, into VGV minus VMO, y minus y1 equal to m into x minus x1. Okay, so here we have got the relation for the surface potential in terms of get to body voltage, and this expression is far more simpler than what we had here. Okay, that relation is much simpler than this surface potential expression psi s, as you can see. So the simplified surface potential expression psi s a can now be can be substituted, psi s can be substituted in the charge density expression. So here the qi prime, you can see, now becomes minus 2 q epsilon s n a upon 2 into square root of 2 f phi t e to the power VGV minus VMO upon n naught phi t. Earlier it was psi s minus twice phi f upon twice phi t. So now the psi s upon twice phi f had been replaced by 1 upon n naught VGV minus VMO. So this has become exponential VGV minus VMO upon n naught phi t. So we can actually club these terms together. Okay, and we can replace them by a single term, which is qm naught. So and minus sign indicating here that basically the charge density is negative. Okay, so qm naught can be used in the above expression, and we'll be able to write down the expression for the total inversion charge density in the depletion region as qi prime equal to qmo prime exponential VGV minus VMO upon n phi t. So in weak inversion region, interestingly, the charge density, electronic charge density, increases exponentially with gate to body voltage, unlike in the strong inversion case. In a strong inversion case, the charge density is large, Qi prime is large, but it will not vary as rapidly as this will vary in the weak inversion region of the device operation. In a strong inversion, we have seen this little bit earlier, some time ago, that Qi prime was equal to minus COx into VGV minus VTO. So here Qi prime was varying linearly with gate to body voltage, but in the weak inversion, Qi prime varies exponentially with gate to body voltage. Okay. So now if we try to visualize a behavior of Qi prime against a large variation in the gate to body voltage, that will include both weak inversion as well as strong inversion, then we'll see the variation of Qi prime with gate to voltage like this. Okay, you see here that in this curve, the natural log of Qi prime is shown, not Qi prime, not mod of Qi prime. This is natural log of Q prime is considered here with gate to body voltage VGV. Okay, and you see that in weak inversion region. So this is our depletion and weak inversion region. So in weak inversion region, the charge density increases linearly. Why linearly? Because this is log of Qi prime, and Qi prime, if you look at Qi prime versus VGV variation, then in this regime, in the depletion, in the weak inversion regime, this Qi prime varies exponentially with gate to body voltage VGV minus VMO upon N naught phi t. Okay, so if you take the log of this, natural log of this, then of course natural log of this, then this natural log exponential, these two will cancel out, and natural log of Qi prime will vary linearly with gate to body voltage. So in weak inversion here, you can see that this curve in charge increases linearly with gate to body voltage. Okay, whereas in strong inversion, the Qi prime varies linearly with gate to body voltage. Qi prime varies linearly with gate to body voltage. So natural log of Qi prime will have a very, very small variation with gate to body voltage. So it is going to be something like this. Very small variation will be seen if we take the natural log of Qi prime at y axis in the strong inversion regime. So you see that in the strong inversion regime, the charge is varying very, very slowly with gate to body voltage, where in weak inversion region, the charge increases exponentially with gate to body voltage, which is actually a linear variation on the logarithmic scale here. Okay, in moderate inversion, basically this is extrapolated, the rate of increment decreases, and finally it becomes linear in the saturation region. So far we have actually we are not going to consider this region, moderate inversion region, because you will see later on that when we will be analyzing the MOS transistor, we will be analyzing either in transistor in the strong inversion regime or in the weak inversion regime. So when the transistor is on, then generally it will be in the strong inversion, because VGV is greater than VTO in that case. And when the transistor is off, where VGV is less than VTO, then basically it will be weak inversion regime. So we are more interested in depletion and weak inversion regime and the strong inversion regime compared to the moderate inversion regime. If you are interested to analyze the moderate inversion regime in more detail, then you can use the expression that we have developed for all region. Okay, we are not going to simplify those expression for this moderate inversion regime of device operation. Okay, so here you have we have first derived the electric field for MOS capacitor. Electric field was that expression was a general expression, and that was valid in all regime of the device operation for a MOS capacitor. Then we simplified from that electric field. Basically, we computed the charge, general charge expression, which was a unified model, and that charge expression was valid in all regime of the device operation. Then we tried to simplify the charge expression for the different regime of operation. We actually simplified the charge expression for the strong inversion case, where we found that the charge increases linearly with gate to body voltage in a strong inversion case. And we also simplified the charge versus gate to body relation in the weak inversion, and there we observed that the charge increases exponentially with the gate to body voltage, and on the linear scale the variation of charge with gate to body voltage is, on logarithmic scale the variation of charge with gate to body voltage is linear one. So this is a summary of our discussion so far. Okay, in next class we will actually discuss about the capacitances, the gate body capacitance, and we'll see how the gate body capacitance will vary with the surface potential, and how the gate body gate body potential may vary with gate to body voltage. So under the different regime of device operation, we'll look at the capacitance variation with the voltage. So so-called CV characteristics of the MOS capacitor will be analyzed at low frequency as well as at high frequency. Okay, thank you very much for hearing me for today's lecture. I will stop here the today's lecture. Okay, and if you have any doubt, then you can feel free to ask. Please feel free.